Anybody out there? Okay. Thank you for coming. I'd like to first acknowledge the Deputy Premier, the Minister, Ms. Nalitha Butterfield, and the Mayor of Hamilton, Mr. Charles Gosling, and of course all the dignitaries that have come. That's the people. In preparing for this event, I noted that people have been doing this for a while. This is my first, and I'm quite ashamed to say that. But when you look at the history, you'll see that friendly societies, Samaritans, various people got together year after year to commemorate this very, very day. And it is indeed an honor and a privilege for me to be here today. To welcome you here in her official capacity is Minister Butterfield.
Good afternoon, all. To our acting premier, the Honorable Paula Cox, JP, MP. To Mayor Gosling. Permanent secretary, my permanent secretary, Ms. Valerie Robinson James, and permanent secretary of Works and Engineering, Mr. Horton. A very special welcome. I had a lovely church service this morning, and much to my surprise, Bermudian, Reverend Christopher, good to see you here. And I think I'm really impressed that you brought 10 overseas guests to Bermuda in celebration of emancipation. And they want to know if they can have dual citizenship. I went quiet. Today, August 1st, is a most important day for all people of African descent throughout the diaspora. This marks the 176th anniversary of the emancipation of African people who had been in slavery throughout the British Empire. This date, August the 1st, is very significant because it was on that day in the year 1834 that slaves were freed, including those who were placed in our homeland of Bermuda. We pause this evening in honor of the most important time in our history as people of African descent to honor, respect, and remember our forefathers and mothers. They demonstrated tremendous fortitude and strength in the face of the cruelties of bondage. They held on to their sense of worth in spite of the dehumanizing treatment that was meted out to them. They never gave up the hope of freedom and self-determination. As a country whose history includes the many experiences of slavery, we must give recognition to this part of our collective heritage. But more importantly, we must teach and inform our children and indeed all of our people. Why? Because those who do not recognize the mistakes of the past are doomed to repeat them. This year, the Emancipation Committee has chosen as its theme, Honoring Bermuda's Emancipation, Respect, Recognition, and Reconciliation. Implied in this theme is also the notion of responsibility, collective responsibility, as a people if we are to truly give evidence to and live out the tenets embodied in this theme in our daily lives, it would take the whole Bermuda village to ensure that what we hope to achieve is actually accomplished. It is the responsibility of each of us to live in such a manner that we demonstrate respect to all, that we give recognition to those aspects of our heritage and culture that has brought hardship to many of us. In moving forward, while we are striving to improve upon and create a more just society in which all people are treated equally, we will continue to work towards reconciliation amongst our people because some lived experience have caused or contributed to division, animosity, antagonism, and bitterness in our society. In the words of the famous reggae artist, Robert Nesta Marley, all of us must emancipate ourselves from mental slavery. None but ourselves can free our own minds. Although this is an individual responsibility, it will greatly impact on how we see ourselves individually and as a proud nation, For I am of the view that emancipating ourselves of mental slavery applies to the descendants of slaves as well as the descendants of slave masters. The mental shackles of slavery have impacted all of us in different ways, of course. We must do this for ourselves, and we must also do this to help bring about a fairer, more just, more humane society. Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. stated, "None of us is entirely free until all are free. Those who enslaved us, as well as those who were enslaved, must come to terms with the cruelties of slavery and seek healing, respect, recognition, and reconciliation." I welcome each of you here this evening in this celebration service of praise and ask that you seriously reflect upon the theme, the readings that you will hear, and that you will give thought of what you would do to further the goals of demonstrating respect, recognition, and reconciliation. Thank you.
Thank you, Minister Butterfield, for those enlightening words. I think it's about time we had a song. What do you think? The Salvation Army Divisional Band is going to lead us in We Have a Dream. We have our first program change. Mrs. Florence Webb Maxwell is unable to read the poem Despair, and so we'll be going into the interpretive dance. But before we go there, I wanted to reflect on this idea of despair and how our people handled the despair on this day way back in 1834. You can imagine being given your freedom without the means of independence, without the means to support yourself. And I think it's instructive for us to remember the role of the friendly societies and other associations that stepped in and provided assistance for those in need. I was looking at some of the financial activities of the friendly societies way back then. Their budget, while meager in those days, £300, you have to remember that £300 back then could buy you a piece of property. So it got me to thinking, how did these former slaves and free people come up with that kind of money year after year after year? It's estimated that about a quarter of the black population of that day was involved in a friendly society or a lodge. That's a significant number of people. That's more than the membership of any single club in this country. Sometimes I wonder how far we've actually come. Perhaps we need to remember the lessons and the fortitude displayed by those folks in the friendly societies. So, on a more upbeat note, can we have the interpretive dancers? Mrs. Casey Morton Simons and Mrs. Dornette Smith. Now we're going to have an original piece of poetry from one of our own, Lauren Francis. And the poem is entitled Hope.
Hope. Our hope is in our history. The stories, our stories. Our journey, our tragedies. There is hope in our memories, our soul memories of survival. For we are the descendants of survivors. Our blood is potent, destined we must be for freedom, true freedom. Our hope is in our history, where it lay for centuries, waiting to emerge from beneath the brutality of our capture and transport, waiting to illuminate the heartless trade of a human commodity, the dehumanization and destruction of our families, waiting for us to uncover the wounds of our rape, our torture, mutilation, to expose the exploitation committed in the name of prosperity. Our hope has the power to free us from the lies and the miseducation that is still used to maintain the gains of iniquity. Our hope is in our ability to heal through honesty. It is in our spirituality, and it is what keeps us sane. Our hope is in our humanity. It is in our ability to forgive, and it has always been there. It's the reason we live. Underwriting the power of our conquering spirit, our collective conscience, our unified cry, scream, and even in our silence, our rebellion against oppression. But it is a hope unfulfilled if our stories remain untold, buried under an illusion of freedom. Our hope is in our ancestry, that magnificent tapestry of color and beauty from the sunfire redness of a Pequot or a Cherokee to the sinewy symmetry of a West African. Our hope is in our cultural tradition. It is in knowing our origin, our heritage. It is in the language we speak, how we sing, how we dance, how we teach, build, and pray. Our hope is in what we do and what we create. It is entrenched in our artistry. It is evident in the brilliance of stonemasonry, sea navigation, boat building, pearl diving, salt raking, fisheries. It can be found at the nexus of our musical genius. It is within the magic of our gombes, our architecture, our agricultural abilities, our culinary uniqueness. It is the hope in the stories of our heroes. And like songs, the names shall roll off our tongues so that those who are lost may find themselves in the pages of ages gone. Hope is in the ability of our children to see their faces in the faces of those who struggle for our emancipation. Our hope is in the stories of truth, victimization, injustice, riots, blacklist, black fist, suppression, trade unions, the last death by hanging, universal suffrage. Hope is found when we can connect the cries, chants, and tears shed throughout our history. Hope is imparted when we cast our eyes unapologetically on our journey, and with unadulterated sight, we can envision the freedom that our ancestors fought for tirelessly. Hope is in exposing the truth of our audacity so that when we speak about liberation, we're not simply referencing a piece of legislation. Hope is in knowing. It is honesty. It is in information. Hope is in the history of our pain, suffering, shame, resistance, and our victory. Hope is in our collective memories, our soul memories passed down to our children. Hope is in the continuation of our fight for true freedom. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Lauren. That was beautiful. Yeah, you're so right. Given how far we've come, we can't afford to lose hope. I know that in these times, sometimes we do feel like giving up, what with all the negativity in our society. But from time to time, I think we need to put these things in context. Let us understand there is no giving up. Up next, we have another song, O Freedom, and the singer, Marvin Ford.
Good afternoon, all.
Oh, freedom. Oh, freedom. Oh, freedom over me. And before I'd be a slave, I'd be buried in my grave and go home to see my Lord and be free. No more mourning, no more mourning, no more mourning over me. And before I'd be a slave, I'd be buried in my grave and go home to see my Lord and be free. There'll be singing, there'll be singing, there'll be singing over me. And before I'd be a slave, I'd be buried in my grave and go home to see my Lord and be free. Oh, freedom. Oh, freedom. Oh, freedom over me. And before I'd be a slave, I'd be buried in my grave and go home to my Lord and be free.
Thank you, Marvin, for that wonderful rendition. Next, we have a young fellow, Carlson Phillips, and he is going to read a poem. Oops, lost my page. The poem. It's written by a Vietnamese monk by the name of Thich Nhat Hanh. Mr. Hanh was born in 1926, which would make him about 84 years old. Mr. Hanh suffered much. I mean, he was Vietnamese. He went through the Vietnamese War. And what was mind-boggling about this man was his ability and his willingness to forgive, or as this poem will show, to reconcile, which is something that we in Bermuda, I suppose, are beginning to tackle. But I'm going to turn it over to Mr. Philip, and he will give you the poem.
Thank you very much. Slight correction. It's actually excerpts from a book he has written. Unfortunately, not a poem. In Plum Village in France, we receive many letters from the refugee camps in Singapore, Malaysia, Indonesia, Thailand, and the Philippines, hundreds each week. It is very painful to read them, but we have to do it. We have to be in contact. We try our best to help, but the suffering is enormous, and sometimes we are discouraged. It is said that half the boat people die in the ocean. Only half arrive at the shores in Southeast Asia. There are many young girls, boat people, who are raped by sea pirates. Even though the United Nations and many countries try to help, the government continues to inflict much suffering on the refugees. One day, we received a letter telling us about a young girl on a small boat who was raped by a Thai pirate. She was only 12, and she jumped into the ocean and drowned herself. When you first learn of something like that, you get angry at the pirate. You naturally take the side of the girl. As you look more deeply, you will see it differently. If you take the side of the little girl, then it is easy. You only have to take a gun and shoot the pirate. But we cannot do that. In my mediation, I saw that if I had been born in the village of the pirate and raised in the same conditions as he was, I am now the pirate. There is a great likelihood that I would become a pirate. I cannot condemn myself so easily. In my mediation, I saw that many babies are born along the Gulf of Siam, hundreds every day. And if we educators, social workers, politicians, and others do not do something about the situation, in 25 years, a number of them will become sea pirates. That is certain. If you or I were born today in those fishing villages, we might become sea pirates in 25 years. If you take a gun and shoot the pirate, you shoot all of us, because all of us are to some extent responsible for this state of affairs. The situation of the world is like this. The people completely identify with one side, one ideology. To understand the suffering and the fear of a citizen of the Soviet Union, we have to become one with him or her. To do so is dangerous. We will be suspected by both sides. But if we don't do it, if we align ourselves with one side or the other, we will lose our chance to work for peace. Reconciliation is to understand both sides, to go to one side and describe the suffering being endured by the other side, then to go to the other side and describe the suffering being endured by the first side. Doing only that will be a great help for peace. In the peace movement, there is a lot of anger, frustration, and misunderstanding. The peace movement can write very good protest letters, but they are not yet able to write a love letter. We need to learn to write a letter to the Congress or to the President of the United States that they will want to read and not just throw away. The way you speak, the kind of understanding, the kind of language you use would not turn people off. The president is a person like any of us. Can the peace movement talk in loving speech, showing the way for peace? I think that will depend on whether the people in the peace movement can be peace. Because without being peace, we cannot do anything for peace. If we cannot smile, we cannot help other people to smile. If we are not peaceful, then we cannot contribute to the peace movement. We rely on each other. Our children are relying on us in order for them to have a future. Respect, recognition, and reconciliation. Thank you.
Thank you, Carlson. And thank you for correcting me. That definitely wasn't a poem. One of my favorite lines in this non-poem, and describe the suffering being endured by the other side, and then go to the other side and describe the suffering being endured by the first side. That takes a lot of courage. I don't know that we in Bermuda are quite ready for reconciliation. I don't know that we're that brave quite yet, but it is something that indeed we need to work towards. Up next, we've got some young people. They've attached electrodes to my body. If I get this wrong and I start to sizzle, you know I got it wrong. Here goes. Troika. Thank you.
respect, rap, conciliation has brought us here today to have an understanding of our past trials and tribulations, to the understanding of redemption, of celebration, of emancipation. Recognition.
Respect.
Reconciliation.
Recognition. Recognize the emancipation of slavery. Recognize the way things happened. Recognize the concepts and tragedies that we were never told about. The beatings that we suffered as a community. Harriet Tubman led the way with the Underground Railroad. She risked her life fighting for freedom. Recognition.
Looking back on the past. Looking back, but not dwelling. We need a reminder of just how far we have come. The fight, the hurt, the blood, sweat, and tears could never be forgotten. But not to make us mean and bitter because of the pain, but to give us strength within. Strength that says that I can overcome anything life throws my way. We must never, ever forget just how far we've come. We must recognize. Recognition.
Respect. The legendary singer Aretha Franklin spells out respect and tells us to find out what it means. Respect, what does it mean to me, to you, to this very country? Hundreds of years ago, our ancestors took the lash of a whip, a backside beating, just so that we can be considered equal. But how do we respect this? By pulling out a gun, verbal abuse, physical abuse. We need to recognize our privileges and not abuse them. Respect.
It is important that we value our freedom and respect those who granted it to us. If it wasn't for them, we wouldn't be able to be ourselves, to be free, to wander these streets with dignity. Be thankful for freedom, but more importantly, be thankful for those brave individuals who sacrificed everything, all so that we, the people of the black race, will be free from the torture of slavery. They stood up for what they believed in, regardless of the possible consequences, the whip of the lash, the torturous heat chamber. They were resilient. Where would we be if they hadn't stood up for themselves, for us, in shackles maybe, being beaten for the color of our skin? Our ancestors paved the way so that we wouldn't have to endure the pain and suffering that they endured for those long, hard years. It is crucial that we recognize what they have done for us and show respect to them for what they have given us today. Respect.
Reconciliation.
Renewal.
Restoration.
Redemption.
Rebuilding.
Freedom.
The healing process.
Moving on after
they paid the price for us.
Heading in the direction of progression.
Reconciliation.
It was a period in time when the people of Africa couldn't speak their mind, compelled to their way of living, ripped, beaten, raped, the definition of mistreatment. Doleful of their skin, wondered day by day if the color was their sin. Day four, they had to protest. Or day they were left in neglect, they did it, and they did it well. Day four, respect. Day four, so that it could be reconciliation. Day four, recognition.
We can sit in the front of the bus. Because of their sacrifice, our lives can be better. Blacks and whites can reside in peace together. Recognize the blood that they bled, the tears that they shed, the struggle to go to school and learn, the respect that needed to be earned. Respect. Respect God, respect others, respect yourself. Only let gratitude come from your mouth. They fought hard for respect to be granted, the same thing that we get, but yet we take advantage. Reconciliation, acknowledging the fact. Moving forward, never moving back. Living together, letting go of the hate. Holding on to grudges is a big mistake. Knowing who you are, being proud to be black. And that is the statement that gets us back to respect.
Today.
to remember the past trials and tribulations and for the celebration of emancipation of present day. Recognition.
Respect.
Reconciliation.
I'm reminded as to why I do what I do. Oftentimes when people meet me in Hamilton, they say, how things are going? I say, well, you know, there are three reasons why I teach. June, July, and you can figure out the rest. I get the opportunity, the privilege to work with people like that and get paid for it. Troika. Coming up next, we're going to have a talk. We've heard a number of themes mentioned today. One of them is development and freedom. And both these concepts require a recognition of the relevance of our shared humanity. It also requires us to be concerned with the process of enhancing our individual freedoms and our social commitment to bring all of this about. And perhaps most importantly in these times, a recognition that there is no substitute for individual responsibility. Responsibility requires freedom. I want to call Mr. Colvin Burchell to the podium to share a couple of words with us.
It's quite intimidating for me to be following behind such talent. I was just joking with one of the dancers that talent must have risen, the quality and level of talent must have risen quite significantly since I was 17. So, but I'll try to follow them as best I can. But before I get into what I have to say here today, I just want us to take a moment to think about what occurred here a century and a bit ago. There were enslaved Africans who first set foot here in Bars Park. And because of the agitation of the friendly societies and other organizations, they were able to be granted their freedom. That's compassionate activism. Okay? That's praying with your hands. Right? Not just having a prayer vigil and then going home, but actually getting your hands dirty through activism and collective activity. I think that's what we need here today. So if you will just close your eyes and for a moment just think about the sacrifice that allowed those enslaved Africans who arrived here on that ship so many years ago to eventually taste the sweet nectar of freedom for the very first time. So with me, just close your eyes. Okay, thank you. I was actually stuck with this speech that I'm gonna share with you. Just a couple of days, I was like, man, what am I gonna say about this? I wanna bring a message to the people that's relevant, that's timely. Well, what exactly am I gonna say? And as fortune would have it, a friend of mine, a younger man, he's in his mid-20s, came over and he was just filling me in about what was really happening in Bermuda, because I'd been living overseas. And at the end of that four-hour conversation, or actually it was about 5 hours, come to think of it, I had all the material that I needed for what I'm gonna share with you today. The young brother is a student of the streets, shall we say. But he has had the opportunity to be able to think in discussions with older gentlemen like myself, older gentlemen, to grapple intelligently with what has brought about this seemingly explosive spate of violence that is presently racking the island. So he told me, Junior, when you're speaking to him, speak for us. Tell the truth. Don't mince your words. And I believe in honoring the youth. I'm gonna speak the truth. I'm not gonna mince my words. And if you find yourself cringing, just bear with me, because there's some young people who live this. He leaves the house smiling, clearly unaware that his life is about to end. I feel the reassuring firmness of the metal against my palm. I close my eyes and recall the chant that my fellow street soldiers often say whenever we get together. We won't stop till all them niggas drop. It's time. The motorbike surges forward. I pull the visor down as I remove the Glock from my pocket and squeeze the trigger. 6 explosions shake my already unsteady hand. The rush is erotic. I revel in my power, and not for the first time. It is a heady feeling that makes me want to scream. 4 bullets pierce the target. I watch him stagger backward as we speed by. I look back and he has fallen to the pavement. There is a growing pool of blood staining the ground under his head. A woman, it could have been his mother, rushes from the house. We don't wait around to hear her anguished screams. Even before I receive confirmation on the 7 o'clock news, I know that he is dead. I am a god. The streets fear me and I love it. And this is my 3rd kill. I want to do it again. Since April 27th, 2003, when Shonda Jones was shot to death outside Club Malabar, Bermuda has been rocked by 13 more gun murders. Let's take a moment to call their names. Jason Lightbourne, Shakai Crockle, Kimwande Walker, Kimwande Robinson, Shane Miners, Akil Richardson, Kumi Harford, Gary Kahn, Dekemo Martin, Perry Puckerin Jr., George Lynch, James Laws, Freddie Mabry. And I've lost count of the number of my brothers whose bodies have been invaded by the deadly penetration of a gunman's bullets, yet have somehow escaped the Grim Reaper's icy caress. Black men have been the victims in every one of these killings, which might better be described as executions. The way that these murders were carried out suggests a reasonable level of planning. The target was identified, his location was determined, visors and dark clothing were donned, license plates were removed, and an escape route was chosen. Black men, and young black men in particular, are becoming recurring decimals of extinguished potential, seemingly born to be immortalized in graffiti scrawled across asphalt and emblazoned on crisp, white bedsheets. their brown faces frozen, unsmiling, multiplied on t-shirts and buttons worn by other black men too damaged to cry. The response of the community was as swift as it was ineffective. Prayer vigils were organized, talk show lines erupted with impassioned commentaries. Ministers from both sides of the house bemoaned the waywardness of the young black male, and renewed calls were made to reinstitute the death penalty. Strangely, no one thought to ask the brothers on the corner, the much maligned Wallflowers, their opinion on how we came to this bloody, loveless place. I feel that the voices of these young men must be heard. What would they say if they were given the time and opportunity to make some sense of the various socio-historical threads that converged to severely curtail their life chances in this, our land of plenty? What might these young men say? And who, would we be brave enough to listen and then act? What's my name? Don't worry about that. It's not important. But you see me every day. On the block, sitting off of my boys by the Parsons Road playground, or drinking and smoking cigarettes across from CNR Discount on the block, or sharing a joke with my brethren out the second. I'm the one you fear. Admit it. You all can't even look me in my face or speak when you pass me by. I'm the one you pray every day that your son never befriends and your daughter never brings home. I'm the garbage that this society has no official place for. And I'm the reflection of your cowardice and your failure. You can't escape me, but you try. Sending your kids to private school and all that. And I can't even blame you. I wouldn't want my son living the street life. It's hard being on my post, rain, blow, or shine. It's hard taking all the risks for such small returns. And now that brothers are shooting to kill, the stakes are really much higher. I know you're asking, why take the risk then? It's not worth it. But it is. The family that I find here is real. They have my back in ways that my hypocrite parents never did. My father cheating on my moms and then singing all loud in the church come Sunday. And my mother taking out her frustration on me with physical and verbal abuse. I try to tell her that I'm not him, but she's too hurt to hear or care. The church folks knew all about the dysfunction in our household, but not one of them, not one, tried to step forward to make sure that the innocent child in the middle of two warring adults didn't get caught down in the crossfire. You'd be surprised how many of us you see juggling and looking all hard have stories just like mine that would make your heart break. I got a friend whose mama's a dopehead. His old man's a drunk and his extended family acts like he doesn't exist. I got another friend who sleeps on the beach because he has no home to go to at night. He's just a few years younger than me. He's 19. I could go on and on and on about that. But thinking about how messed up things are for us just makes me mad. So we gather because our scars are similar. We gather to provide the support that was denied us by you, our protectors. We gather because there is familiar dismissive silence around the crimes committed against us. The sort of silence that says loud and clear, you don't matter. Let your suffering be yours to bear, alone. Too few people stood up for us. You tell us, respect your elders. But you tell me, what should we do when our elders turned their backs on us when we needed them most? When we realized that you all were not there for us in the ways that we needed you to be, the whole idea of respecting you because you're older than us fell by the wayside. The connection that you should have been responsible for developing and maintaining rotted and fell away, and your petty concerns and self-righteous pronouncements fell on deaf ears. You were and are dead to us. Your words do not reach us because we don't believe that you really love us, because if you did, you couldn't walk by us without offering a hand. You could not do that. All that I'm sharing with you, I understood by the time I was M1, 11 years old. Fresh out of primary school. You know what? If someone did check for us, I mean really check for us, from the heart with true understanding and without fear, there's no end to what we would be willing to do for that person. And it's that level of understanding, acceptance, and safety that we find on the streets. I know that enough guys on the street, and not just here in Bermuda, but on street corners across the world, are masking their pain with violence or sex or drugs because the adults have failed to provide a version of manhood that doesn't require that they repress their feelings. To be very blunt, your failure has given birth to a poisonous rage within many of us that we can neither fully comprehend nor effectively articulate, but it must be expressed somehow. The equation goes something like this. Anger unvented becomes pain. Pain unspoken becomes rage. Rage released becomes violence. That's what happened in the Durante Dill case. Remember that? He said that he was angry, but when pressed, couldn't state what it was that made him so enraged that he brutally murdered two people. I don't know the name of the poet who first said this, but whoever it was, he hit it. We wear the mask that grins and lies. If we don't find ways to challenge this toxic version of manhood, we will essentially be guaranteeing that our young and vulnerable sons will continue to provide the funeral directors with work. Who do you think is responsible for pulling the trigger? Let me tell you if you don't know. Cats younger than me. I'm talking 15, 16, 17-year-olds. The guy who got shot at Frizzle's Hill a few weeks ago, he was an S1 student at Cedar Bridge. That's what you're dealing with. And they have absolutely no fear of running up on you while you're eating your Sunday dinner to put a bullet in your child. Being accepted, being seen as a real man worthy of respect, never mind that I'm only 15 and still living with my mother, is important enough to risk death or life in prison to get. And the quickest way to win that respect is to show that you're willing to become a nigger killer. Yeah, a nigger killer, that's what I said. We aren't killing the white folks who stole Tucker's Town, or the white folks who made up the 40 Thieves, or the white folks who killed Buck and Larry, or the white folks who still benefit from the unacknowledged crime of slavery and the denial of reparations. No, our target, with the exception of Mr. Gaglio and Ms. Kuchler, is always another black male. Why is it that we almost never aim our weapons at those who laid the foundation for virtually all that is broken in our communities? Why is that? Why do we never discuss their violence against us, which has played such a large role in creating this state of self-hatred and decay amongst folk who look like me? I went reading because, as I learned from my Ashe in my Ashe Rites of Passage class while I was a student at Dulwood Middle School, I have to be awake, alert, and aware. The teacher, Mrs. Van Putten, would always tell us that we should research if we want to understand something, and that's what I'm trying to do now. So this Norwegian sociologist, Johan Galtung, said, and I quote, "Personal violence is for the amateur in dominance, but structural violence is the tool of the professional. The amateur who wants to dominate uses guns. The professional uses social structure. The legal criminality of the social system and its institutions of government and of individuals at the interpersonal level is tacit violence. Structural violence is a structure of exploitation and social injustice. Here on this rock, we haven't really begun to deal with the structural violence that created what we now see throughout the nine parishes. We don't want to touch that discussion with a 10-foot pole. And I say we, as in black folk. In fact, it was black folk who chased the Ashe program out of the middle school system and robbed us of a tool that we could use to understand how we came to be in the predicament that we're in today. That program opened my eyes to the fact that we weren't always in this state. It was the first time that I began to think that maybe, just maybe, a black life and black people were worth something. Mrs. Van Putten gave us another way of viewing ourselves and the true causes of the violence in our community. She challenged us to start from the beginning in order to understand today. She dared us to reject the stereotypes and make ourselves over, using the best of our history as a guidepost for what each of us has the potential to achieve. Looking back, I understand that what she was doing was very dangerous. That is, if you want black youths to remain completely ignorant of who they are as African descended people. Black Bermudian adults are really uncomfortable with that idea. That's why you all turned your back on that shade. But the truth is, when you turn your back on your past, you also put us, your children, at risk. Essentially, the ground upon which we can build a coherent sense of self is cut away. Life becomes cheap, and the prospect of our death becomes a matter of indifference. The end result? Black bodies crowding the morgue, not just in King Edward, but in morgues and hospitals in cities throughout the world. The violence in Bermuda finds its tragic reflection in Jamaica, in Trinidad and Toronto, as well as in the major urban centers in the US and the UK. In fact, wherever black folk are denied a full understanding of the history and culture and the role that racism plays in the maintenance of racial inequality in the present day, black blood is guaranteed to be spilled by self-hating black hands. In spite of the mountain of evidence that points to a link between the legacy of racism and so-called black-on-black violence, we on this rock choose to look away. Prayer will set us free, or maybe yet another peace rally will do the trick. But that race stuff seems too dangerous, too painful a topic to safely broach in polite company. The Mincy report tiptoed around it, instead suggesting that we should focus on ensuring that teachers have high expectations for black male students and that we should promote the development of so-called soft skills amongst this at-risk demographic. Now, don't get me wrong, that's important, but we must go deeper than that. If we don't start at the beginning, how then can we really hope to stem the flow of blood, of black blood? We, the so-called gun-toting youths, the so-called thugs, are the symptom, not the problem, you know. Never forget this fact. Question: have you told your black boys anything about their history before slavery? Have you revealed to us the beauty of African culture and the genius to be found therein? Have you told us that our lives have value beyond the damaging stereotypes about black people in general and black males in particular that are fed to us through the media? Have you told us that, like Gao Tung was saying, the social dynamics of this country were shaped by the deliberate acts of soul-destroying structural violence orchestrated by the Goslings, the Trimiums, the Gibbonses, the Tuckers, the Dills, and the other white elites, and that what we're doing to each other in the streets was not born in a vacuum? Have you told them this? In other words, have you bothered to tell us the truth? In a word, no. We don't know who we are, how we got here, and have no real plan beyond mere survival. And frankly, that level of not knowing has driven many of us insane enough to seek death through the cold-blooded murder of our own black male reflections. So, if we're serious about this whole respect, recognition, and reconciliation thing, we clearly have a lot of in-house work to tackle before we extend ourselves to the white community. You see, the three R's are very personal. You must start at home, if you will, before you venture out into the world. In fact, attempting to wander abroad without first correctly orienting our cultural compasses has left too many of us lost and confused and unable to come up with real solutions to our problems. The Oxford English Dictionary defines reconciliation as the act of bringing about harmony, the act of befriending again after an estrangement. Recognition is defined as the state or quality of being recognized or acknowledged. And respect is understood to mean to regard with esteem or honor, to refrain from offending, corrupting, harming, degrading, insulting, or injuring. Right now, there is a huge rift in the black community between the older generation and the younger. On one side, there is condemnation, shame, and fear. On the other, anger and disappointment. We are estranged from one another and struggle to cross this chasm because we refuse, maybe because of cowardice or ignorance or both, to engage in truth-telling. And that's what the three R's are built on. Without truth as the foundation, the likelihood that we'll see recognition, reconciliation, and respect between the older and the younger generations of black folk on this island, and in particular, young black males who have given themselves over to the street life, is slim to nil. And truth extends itself to self-examination. I dare every adult black person in this audience to find answers to these questions. How has living in this island with its happy face, well-mannered, covert racism left many of you psychologically scarred? How has buying into a destructive form of black manhood left many adult black males emotionally crippled and ill-equipped to constructively interact with and act as compassionate guides for young black boys? How many of you would be able to do the painful work of uncovering your own trauma? How many of you have become too comfortable swallowing your pain and living with internal disharmony and low racial self-esteem to be able to reach out to your children and give them the assistance that they require, never mind reaching across the racial divide? So, although it may not sound like much of a beginning, we need to start with honest conversation. You are not the well-adjusted, civic-minded, law-abiding citizens that you think you are. And the brothers on the corner are not mindless savages who deserve to be thrown into prison and forgotten. These are but two of the many lies that must be cast aside as you seek to rebuild the bridge between your sons and yourselves. And you must be real, not condescending, not fearful. We can see through that and will quickly shut you down if you approach us that way. Only genuineness, consistency, and courage amongst adult Black Bermudians will make possible the transformative connection in the street soldiers like the one I described at the beginning. Can we do it? I believe that we can do it by recognizing, respecting, and reconciling with that part of ourselves that has been so much abused by racism, and then working hard to greatly expand the emotional vocabulary of Black boys. Again, we must use the three R's on ourselves first before we go anywhere else. We must then be brave enough to apply the many lessons of history to the cause of saving Black boys put at risk by our many silences. So we return to where we began, with the gunman on the back of the motorbike. But there's a difference. He leaves the house with a smile on his face, clearly unaware that his life is hanging in the balance. I feel the reassuring firmness of the metal against my palm. I close my eyes and recall the chant that my fellow street soldiers often say whenever we get together. We won't stop till all them niggas drop. It's time. The motorbike surges forward. I pull the visor down as I remove my Glock from my pocket. My finger rests on the trigger, but I do not squeeze. For some reason, I recall the conversations that I've been having with JR, an older man who has known me since I was a baby and has been coming to check for me regularly since I was in P2. He'd always say, "A rebel is someone who does what he's not supposed to do." Like Paulu, like Malcolm X, like Kingsley Tweed. When you aim to kill another brother, you can't call yourself a budman. You're just doing what they want you to do, which means you're a tool and a slave. Ain't no rebel behavior in killing Black men like the KKK and the slave master did, is there? Damn, he's right. The gun is silent and still in my already unsteady hand. I watch my target jump back in surprise as we speed by. I look back and he's glaring angrily in our direction. A woman, it could have been his mother, rushes from the house. It's all over in a matter of seconds, and no one got shot. I had failed to carry out the hit. Beneath my visor, I feel good, and I know why. Like a real rebel, I had chosen life. I want to do it again. Black Bermuda, we know what we have to do. The life or death question that you now must ask and then answer is this. Are you willing to save our young Black males by becoming the change that you want to see in them? Put another way, are you truly willing to do what really needs to be done to stop the killing? And beyond that, what are you going to do? Thank you.
The wonderful thing about young people, they're not afraid, and perhaps their biggest asset is their honesty. We old people, we're too busy shucking and jiving, making believe. They say the definition of insanity is what? Doing the same thing over and over and over again and expecting a different result? Yeah. I like the young. Thank you. Thank you so much, Colburn, for putting it in our face. I wish I could keep playing the tape over and over and over again, because it needs to be there. We're going to finish here with a congregational song, Lift Every Voice and Sing. At this time, I'm going to ask you all to stand. This concludes this service of praise. I want to thank you for coming. I also want to thank the organizing committee for putting this wonderful event together. And now there's one order of business that remains, and that is to enjoy the refreshments that your taxpayer dollars have provided for us here today. So with that in mind, could you please retire? Oh, here's my chain being pulled. We don't want a whole crowd.
So if we could get people to just give a minute, we're gonna try and serve our special guests and then, okay?
Yes, so if you could give us a minute, we're going to try and serve our special guests and then we'll turn it open to the lumpen proletariat.
Just to let you know, we found a ring, and if you can describe your ring, you can get it back. If you lost a ring, and you can describe your ring that you lost, you can get it back, okay?